100 years ago, the planet was reeling from one of the deadliest pandemics in history. A highly contagious influenza virus had swept through almost every country on Earth. One in three people fell ill. For perhaps one in five of them, the infection was fatal. It was a catastrophic blow for a world already struggling to recover from the devastating consequences of the First World War. Yet once the pandemic subsided, the world recovered and seemed to move on, even though it had claimed millions of lives, more than World War I, or possibly more than both the 20th century's world wars put together. It became known as the forgotten epidemic, until interest in global pandemics, and especially the current coronavirus crisis, put it back under the spotlight. I'm Bridget Kendall, and today's edition of The Forum from the BBC World Service is devoted to the Spanish flu pandemic of 1918, where it might have originated, what measures against its deadly march proved effective, and why it was known as the Spanish flu when it didn't start in Spain. I'm joined by three experts from different parts of the world to explore the history of the Spanish flu and what we can learn from this earlier global pandemic to help us better understand how to combat the COVID-19 virus, which is affecting all our lives today. Sven-Erik Mamerlund is research professor at the University of Oslo in Norway. He's been studying the 1918 pandemic for 24 years and is one of the authors of the World Health Organization's Pandemic Preparedness Plan, published last year. Siddharth Chandra is a health economist. He's director of the Asian Studies Department at Michigan State University in the United States and professor in the Department of Epidemiology and Statistics. And Laura Spinney is a science writer and journalist. She's author of Pale Rider, The Spanish Flu of 1918 and How It Changed the World. Welcome to you all. And Laura, can I start with you? Because I want to begin by describing the virus that became known as Spanish flu, because it was different from today's COVID-19 virus, wasn't it? Though it shared many characteristics.
Yes, it was a strain of the influenza virus, so it belonged to a different family from the coronaviruses. Of course, what they have in common is that they're both respiratory diseases. But never before has a coronavirus caused a pandemic. This is a first in that sense.
Well, the Spanish flu, as it was called that not because it originated in Spain, but because Spain, unlike the rest of Europe, was not under military censorship. And so instances of the virus were more widely reported there, especially after the King of Spain fell ill with it. In fact, the first recorded case of the Spanish flu virus was in the United States at a military camp in Kansas on March 4, 1918. Soldiers were preparing to join the war in Europe and a mess cook called Albert Gitchell fell ill, becoming the first recorded case of some 500 million cases worldwide eventually. So, Laura, what were the initial symptoms of the Spanish flu?
In the vast majority of people, they were flu as we know it. That's a really important thing to say. It was a sore throat, fever, headache. But then in some people, it went on to become something much worse. It became, you know, they had had difficulty breathing. They would turn blue in the face, an effect that doctors called heliotrope cyanosis. And even in some cases, they would start bleeding from their noses and mouths. And then in a small minority of cases, the blue would turn to black. And at that point, there was really very little hope of recovery. And people would die within hours or days.
Well, those sorts of symptoms from the Spanish flu 100 years ago do sound somewhat different from what we know about COVID-19, which typically the onset is a high temperature and a cough, a dry cough. But there are other similarities, aren't there? For example, in serious cases, in both epidemics, the antibody system goes out of control and pneumonia can set in.
Yes, absolutely. So that's really interesting because, in fact, what kills in both diseases seems to be a massive inflammatory reaction. In both cases, it's true that at the very end, in the terminal stage, if you like, there is not much virus left in the lung. It's the inflammatory reaction that is doing all the damage. It's called a cytokine storm in technical terms.
And there's another big difference between these two epidemics too, isn't it? Which is the kind of people who found that they were vulnerable. We're very attuned to the fact here that particularly elderly people are vulnerable, but much younger people don't seem to me. But that was different in 1918, wasn't it?
Yeah, and that's why it was, one of the reasons why it was so absolutely devastating. I mean, flu normally affects the very young and the very old, but in 1918, the most vulnerable age group was those between 20 and age 40. And that means it was killing the kind of breadwinners, the pillars of families and communities at a time when there wasn't much of a social welfare net and leaving behind all kinds of dependents. So it was devastating, obviously, to individuals, but also to communities.
Now, Siddharth, you've tracked how British India was particularly badly affected by the virus, with an estimated 17 to 18 million fatalities, I believe. What do we know about how the virus got there, where it arrived in India, and how it spread?
The story of how the virus got to India is quite similar to the story of how it reached many other parts of the world. As demobilization was taking place in Europe during the end of the First World War, a number of British Indian troops got onto ships to come back home to India. And it's believed that they brought the influenza virus on a troop ship that was destined for Bombay, what's now called Mumbai, on the western coast of India on the Arabian Sea. And from there, we've studied the evolution of this pandemic across the Indian subcontinent. And what we see is waves of mortality cresting in western India first, not too long after that on the southeastern part of India, which is the location of Madras, now known as Chennai, which was in itself a major garrison town. But after having hit the west coast of India and the southern part of the Indian peninsula, the pandemic moved almost wave-like north and eastward until it exited India on the northeastern side, beyond what is now the state of West Bengal.
Now, India is an interesting case because the common assumption is that flu is a winter illness, attacking people once the cold weather sets in. So I wonder why you think it created such havoc in India with its warm environment. Isn't flu supposed to hate sunshine and hot weather?
This is a very important point because we are seeing echoes of this phenomenon with the coronavirus as well. And we know that coronaviruses are also very strongly seasonal in their character. For example, there's a cold season, and it usually occurs during the colder and drier times in the year. So then why then was India so badly affected by the influenza pandemic? If you think about the virus, the influenza virus, it is a parasite. It needs a host in order to survive. And so you would expect that if somebody coughs out the virus in a hot and humid climate, then the survival time for that virus is going to be much shorter than it would be in a cooler and drier climate. And so one can hypothesize that even though the temperature, the climatic conditions in India were not ideal for the spread of the virus, it was probably very effective in spreading for two reasons. First, that the populations were immunologically naive. The bodies had not yet experienced this virus and were not able to mount effective immune responses. But secondly, and very importantly, the more densely populated districts of India suffered a heavier toll in percentage terms than did the less densely populated districts. And what this suggests to us is that the proximity of people to each other was high enough that the virus didn't need to survive for very long periods of time in this hostile, hot and humid climate in order to be effectively transmitted.
Sven Erik, can I bring you in now on the global picture for the 1918 pandemic? Because you've been looking at this for over two decades, and I wonder what your observations have shown on a global scale. What kind of people were most vulnerable and how their profile compares with those most at risk around the world today?
Well, so we believe that something between 50 and 100 million people died on a global scale. So that would be something between 2.5% and 5% of the inhabitants died. But we saw large variation across countries. For example, mortality per population was below 1% in North America, in Europe, in Australia. But India had 10 times higher mortality than Norway. But we also saw that some particular groups were harder hit than others. For example, we saw that Labrador, which basically have indigenous populations living there, like the Inuits, they had a mortality of 1/3. So a third of the people in Labrador died. The corresponding mortality in Alaska was 8%. And we also saw a very high mortality in the Pacific. For example, on Western Samoa, mortality was 24%.
And so what do we read into that? Is this about overcrowding, as we heard from Siddharth, or is it other factors, being susceptible because no immunity, or other things still, like, for example, malnourishment?
I believe that the Spanish flu virus was worse than its reputation, because if it wasn't for the fact that a large part of the population, at least those living in Northern America, in Europe, in Australia, New Zealand, in well-connected societies and cities, they had some pre-existing immunity to fight this 1918 flu virus, especially among the elderly. But in some of these isolated places in the world, they had less immunity.
Let's just focus a bit on this question of immunity. It's said that maybe people who'd experienced earlier flu outbreaks, like the Russian flu pandemic some 30 years before, may have had greater defences. So if that's the case, would you have expected that in the current pandemic that people who had been experienced earlier outbreaks might have more resistance?
Yeah, it's actually a possibility that having gone through other cold viruses, you can have some types of cross immunity, because we know that a lot of people don't show symptoms at all or are asymptomatic, and a lot of people have just mild symptoms, but it's not settled yet. We don't know too much about it.
Laura, going back to 1918, in the absence of all these possibilities of vaccine and so on that we're hoping for today, what did people take to make them feel better? Because pharmacology was in its infancy too, wasn't it? So what was popularly prescribed?
Yes, it was still a time of sort of concoctions and plant-based cures and not very scientific at all. They had no antivirals, no antibiotics, which would have treated the bacterial pneumonia that killed most victims, and no vaccine. What did they have to fall back on? They had the so-called wonder drug, aspirin, though they probably gave it at far too high doses, aggravating the underlying inflammation. They gave the anti-malarial drug quinine. And the irony of that is that a relative of quinine, hydroxychloroquine, also an anti-malarial drug, is being prescribed for COVID today. They also gave that probably in too high doses, provoking tinnitus, vomiting, and other side effects, which in some cases might have been worse than the disease itself. They tried anything and everything in their medicine cabinet. And then when those didn't work, they fell back on even more ancient cures. So some doctors in some parts of the world tried bloodletting. There was recourse to what we would call the alternative medicine, although it didn't take on that name until after the pandemic, things like homeopathy. And when those didn't work, it was home remedies, folk cures, burning mixes of herbs in front of the house, and finally, prayer.
Well, there was, of course, also mitigation, new ways of behaving to try and protect people from the contagion in 1918. So, Laura, tell us a bit more about what social distancing there was in Europe, for example. You're in Paris at the moment, aren't you, where there's pretty much a lockdown. Presumably, it wasn't quite what you're experiencing today.
No, lockdown is completely unprecedented. We've never done this before. There were public health measures. And in fact, I think what's fascinating is that in this period before we have a vaccine, and of course, the pandemic may finish before a vaccine is available, we are thrown back essentially on the same social distancing and physical distancing techniques that they used 100 years ago. And those measures are really ancient. Isolation, quarantine, cordon sanitaire, these things. We've always done these, even before germ theory, even before we understood that microbes transmitted disease, we understood that you needed to keep the healthy and the sick apart. And in fact, in 1918, they had many of the same debates. Masks, do they work? Disinfectant. There was a debate in the newspapers in Paris at the time. So there was confused messaging. There was everything you see today.
We were talking earlier about how crowding in large cities could provide opportunities for infection to spread rapidly. In your book, Pale Rider, you describe apocalyptic scenes in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, where the city government was completely overcome by the challenge of dealing with the dead. And many cities went into meltdown, didn't they? Although not everywhere. In New York, didn't they weather the story quite well through an enlightened administrator?
Yeah, they had an enlightened health commissioner called Royal S. Copeland. He did many good things. He had his hands tied because the president of the United States, Woodrow Wilson, was determined not to put too many controls on New York, which was the main point of embarkation for the troops going to Europe. Don't forget, we were in the middle of the, or at the end anyway, of the First World War. But he did what he could in the circumstances. The first was that he staggered rush hour by staggering the opening and closing times of shops and factories. Then he instigated a sort of clearinghouse system across the city to triage patients for medical care, which is sort of what you're seeing again today with big tents outside of hospitals to try and separate the COVID and the non-COVID patients. And the third thing he did, which was controversial, was that he decided to keep the schools open. And a lot of criticism came down on his head for that. In the neighbouring states, Massachusetts and New Jersey, they closed the schools. And I think what's interesting about his decision is that it shows perhaps how the right decision in one place may not be the right decision in another place. Because from what we can tell from the archives, he was thinking a lot about the children of immigrant families who lived in very crowded tenements, in bad conditions, malnourished often. And he wanted to keep them basically under surveillance, perhaps fed too. And he wanted also to use them to transmit public health messages back to their families who often did not speak English.
Very interesting. Siddharth, you've done a detailed study of social distancing in 1918 across the state of Michigan, where you're based in the US. A 3-week restriction was imposed and then lifted at the same time across all 83 counties, wasn't it? Despite them having different levels of exposure to the virus. I realise this is new research and not yet published, but what did you discover about the optimum timing of restrictions for the 1918 epidemic?
One of the things that we discovered when we were looking at the data, not just for Michigan, but for the entire United States, is during October of 1918, when the lethal wave of the pandemic washes across many countries in the world, in the United States, we sometimes see a double bump. So if the restrictions on movement were imposed very early in the course of that October wave in a county, then as soon as it was lifted 3 weeks later, the epidemic took off in that county. And so what you would see is this very lopsided pattern of infections where you would see very little in October 1918, but then in December 1918, you'd see a very high peak. For areas like Detroit, which is one of the epicenters of the coronavirus pandemic today in Michigan, we see the opposite. It was one of the early places to be infected in 1918 and was, in fact, one of the triggers for the imposition of these restrictions on movement. And because Detroit had the imposition in place relatively late during its autumn wave, we don't see much of a second wave when the restrictions are lifted.
Sven-Erik, I wondered about measures to counter the movement of pandemics today, given the way our world is so globally interconnected. I mentioned that you helped write the WHO's preparedness plan published last year, and I wondered what advice there was there and how far it's proved to be a useful blueprint for what we're experiencing now.
Yes. If you had any type of pandemic, we suggested to, you know, have proper hand hygiene, respiratory etiquette, use face masks for symptomatic individuals, surface and object cleaning, increased ventilation and isolation of sick individuals, and also to give travel advice. So if you went on to have a moderately severe pandemic, you should do all of the ones that I've just mentioned, plus avoiding crowding. If you went on to a high severity pandemic, we suggested to also use face masks for the public and also to close down schools. And if you had an extraordinary severe pandemic, we would suggest everything that I just mentioned, plus closing down workplaces and as well as imposing international travel restrictions. But we did not suggest to close down borders or the lockdowns that we see across the globe today.
Laura, we've already made mention of the second wave of the Spanish flu virus that came in the final months of 1918, and which was far more dangerous than the earlier and later waves. Was it a total surprise?
Not an entire, a complete surprise in some parts of the world. In some parts of the world, people had remembered or noticed that flu pandemics came in waves, but they couldn't have said anything about when or how severe. It erupted in the latter part of August in the Northern Hemisphere, and it was far more severe. The thinking at the moment is that at some point in the summer, the virus mutated. So when it re-erupts in August, it's now the highly virulent pure pandemic strain, and it's very contagious and it spreads everywhere. So that was the one that was basically responsible for the vast majority of the 50 million deaths. That virus emerged in the summer, which is very unflu-like. And I just wanted to say everything that Siddharth said earlier about the seasonality of flu is of obviously correct, but we don't yet know about the seasonality of this coronavirus. And some of the coronavirus experts I've been talking to are very anxious about the narrative that is going around that it may be seasonal and that warm weather might protect some of the countries in the global south, whereas there's no evidence for that.
Well, I'm sure everybody listening will want to hope that this time we might be able to avoid a second wave of COVID-19 later this year, and that if it does come, it will be less dangerous than it is at the moment. Sven Erik, what's your view on this? Can you give us any assurance?
No, I'm afraid not. But the point about these NPIs, these non-pharmaceutical interventions, is see that this wave is going to be quite long and flat. But once we lift some of these interventions again, I'm quite concerned that we will see an upsurge in new cases and new hospitalizations and deaths. So we might have more waves for sure, but not necessarily more lethal second or later waves.
Laura, your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think it essentially depends on us. I think that's the point. From what I can tell, the coronaviruses they're not very changeable. They're much less changeable in themselves than the flu virus. So the opinion seems to be that this virus is unlikely to mutate into something worse. But there could be a second. Well, there's even likely to be a second wave because of human behavior. So essentially, it's up to us how big or how small that wave is, and it will all be about how we come out of lockdown and understanding that lockdown is not the end of it and that we're going to have to come out in a very graded, gradual way.
Thanks to all three of you. I'm Bridget Kendall, and we're discussing the mother of all pandemics, the Spanish flu, which infected 500 million people across our planet a century ago. What do we know about the nature and spread of that pandemic, and what can it tell us about coronavirus today? Sven Erik, what happened to the survivors? You've made a study of the impact on mental health, haven't you? What did you find?
Yeah, that's a good question. From reading literature on the 1918 flu, I saw that there was just lots of anecdotes about people struggling mentally after the flu. And what I saw was that there was an increase in the number of hospitalizations at asylums due to the flu. And there's one study that found for the US that one more death per year per 1,000 population increased the rate of suicides by 10% in the US, controlling for First World War casualties, deaths, and also the decline in alcohol consumption in the US between 1910 and 1920. And for that study on suicides and also the link between the 1918 flu and mental illness, we believe that there are at least three explanations. One is this fear factor, and a second one is a bereavement factor. For example, if you lost your husband or kids or some near relatives, you got so devastated by these losses. And also the third factor that there was a drop in social integration during the 1918 flu, just as you see it today, you know, when we close down schools and have these lockdowns, you see a drop in social integration. And I have one example from a city of Stavanger on the west coast of Norway. It's a family of six before the 1918 flu. Two of the kids in this family is dying from the 1918 flu. And also the dad in this family is dying. And a couple of days after these three people have been buried, the neighbors are looking for the mother. The mother is gone missing. And the police is searching for her. And after a couple of days, they find her in the harbor of Stavanger. And she had drowned herself because of all of the sorrow that her husband and two of her kids died. And two of her orphans were put into orphanages after this episode.
That's a really tragic story, Sven-Erik. And it reminds us of all the individual and family losses that there always are behind the statistics of a pandemic. Laura, it also raises this question of orphans and orphanages. Because as you said, the virus affected people in their 20s disproportionately, meaning those of child-rearing ages. And this led to a huge number of orphans, didn't it? How did countries adapt to cope?
Well, I mean, the great tragedy is that we don't really see them. There must have been millions of orphans. We don't really have any data for them. We know from South Africa that there were around 500,000 orphans created, but we don't really have good numbers for the rest of the world. And they just sort of vanish into the cracks of history. There was no real organized adoption at the time. There was no real social welfare net. So they got taken in, we think, for the most part, by extended families or became wards of state. And in some countries had a more unhappy destiny. They became vagrants or criminals or prostitutes or went into service. So it's a real tragedy. And there's also the other end, because if you think about the dependence of those people who died in the middle age group, the elderly, what happened to them? They also lost their, you know, only visible means of support. And in some countries, you know, you see movements. We only get glimpses again. It's pretty anecdotal. But they move into workhouses.
Let's move on to something a bit more cheerful. Siddharth, how long was it before the world bounced back in terms of the economy and, of course, fertility too?
I think in terms of the economy, it took the world about between a year and 2 years, depending on how badly affected the population was, to bounce back. In terms of fertility, one of the things we discovered is that about 9 months after, which is the gestation period for a human baby, 9 to 10 months after the peak in mortality, at least in the United States, we see a significant dip in the number of babies being born. I think Sven-Erik may know something about what followed, but the immediate, the short-term birth consequences of the 1918 pandemic were quite devastating for populations.
So can I bring you in, Sven-Erik, there?
Yes. Well, so basically what we saw across all of the globe where we had good data, we see that, as Sid said, a dip in fertility, or rather the conception rates during the peak of the pandemic in the fall of 1918. But that most of these postponed conceptions were actually caught up, and even more of the of these conceptions were caught up in 1919, such that you actually had a big baby boom across the globe in 1920.
Laura, at the moment, people are very focused on their health services, aren't they? All around the world, people are willing them to succeed under extreme pressure. In your book, you say that the 1918 Spanish flu virus fundamentally changed the way we view healthcare and the role of the state, and indeed that it laid the foundation for universal healthcare systems in some countries. So how did it do that?
So I think people were talking about the concept of socialized healthcare, you know, healthcare that's free for everybody at the point of delivery, for some time before the pandemic. But it's an extraordinary ask to put such a system in place, because essentially you first of all have to work out how you're going to pay for it. And then you have to completely reorganize your provision from sort of tip to root. And before the pandemic, most doctors either worked for themselves or for charities or for religious associations. So it would have taken an enormous amount of organization. And I think the power to do that was not really there before the pandemic.
We're talking about Europe here mainly, presumably.
Yes, and the United States as well, and other places. But yes, let's say the wealthy world. I think the pandemic gave it a huge stimulus, and you can sort of trace it through in the debate in some countries. And basically, you see, from the 1920s, these systems come into play. Russia was the first. Vladimir Lenin was the moving force behind that, because he'd seen essentially the working class in Russia almost wiped out by famine and civil war and epidemics. And so his idea of socialized medicine was very focused at the beginning on epidemics specifically. It wasn't completely universal to start with, because it was just for people who lived in cities, but gradually he added in the rural populations. The countries of Western Europe followed suit. And the United States also, although it took a different path to paying for it, as we know, it was mainly paid for through employer-based insurance schemes, whereas ours in Europe were mainly paid by national insurance schemes and taxes. And obviously those took decades to be put in place, but the building blocks start from the 1920s.
Sven-Erik, what do you think about the case that we have now? If the 1918 epidemic made some significant changes over time, like health systems, should we expect something similar to happen after COVID-19 has passed?
That's a very good question. I mean, if I just go back to the 1918 flu pandemic, I think it's difficult to sort of pinpoint exact relationship between that episode and, for example, the building up of welfare states, because, for example, we know from South Africa that they introduced a widow pension scheme after the 1980 flu as a direct consequence. I think they introduced a pension scheme for widows in Oslo in 1919 after the pandemic. But the debates about it was also talked about before the pandemic. So it's difficult to say that there's a direct relationship between the 1918 pandemic crisis and, you know, developments of welfare states across the globe.
And so what about this time around?
Right. I'm not quite sure that much will happen. Or, I mean, in the short term, of course, I mean, we know, for example, from Norway, so we have at 11% unemployment rate right now. So, of course, a lot of these people that have become unemployed, they will consume less and they will, you know, change their behavior and because they have lost their jobs. But I guess that, you know, most people, once they get back to normal life, once they get back their jobs eventually, most people will just return back to normalcy and live their lives just as they did before this crisis. So it's difficult to say exactly how individuals and families and societies and systems will change as a direct consequence of this.
Siddhartha, I had another question for you. It's extraordinary when you look back to note how swiftly the epidemic's waves seemed to come and go in 1918 and 1919, given how very devastating it was. And yet we've been talking about how today governments are trying to slow down the rate of infection. And so I wonder, do you think that means that our sense of living with this epidemic, the coronavirus epidemic, will be longer too? And maybe that means that the impact on our economies and on our social behaviour may go deeper and may last longer. What do you think about that?
I believe that will probably be the case. I think the longer you keep an economy in sort of suspension, if you will, the more far-reaching will be the negative economic consequences. And in the case of the 1918 pandemic, as you said, governments did make efforts to impose social distancing measures, but those waves were relatively short. So I completely agree. I think that the economic consequences are going to be perhaps more devastating today than they were certainly in percentage terms in 1918. And this is why pulling out of our social distancing measures and how we do it is going to be critical, because we want to protect those still susceptible people, but we do want the economy to come back onto its trajectory, its pre-pandemic trajectory.
We're coming towards the end of our discussion, but there's one big question that I wanted to explore briefly with all three of you, because one thing that's very different from 1918 is the way that we're so much more connected in many ways than we were then. Of course, that's a problem for infectious diseases spreading more quickly, but in some ways it's a bonus. We've mentioned the way scientists are looking to understand the virus and combat it, and they're sharing their research to make faster progress around the globe. So it raises the question, when it comes to curbing and withstanding pandemics, are we in better shape than 100 years ago or not? Sven-Erik, what do you think?
Well, I do believe that we are in better shape today. So we have a better surveillance of viruses, both in animals and in humans. We have preparedness plans in place. We have better pre-existing health and better social conditions and better health services and better housing and so on. But on the other hand, we are more people on the globe today than 100 years ago. More people live in cities, more people travel, you know, communication means are faster. So, you know, in that sense, you will also have a faster spread. And we also have an older population today, which are also more susceptible, you know, in terms of underlying health conditions and so on. And we also today have a large part of the population on the globe are experiencing obesity. So obesity is a risk factor that we have today that we didn't have back in 1918. And still today, a lot of people live in poverty. And HIV/AIDS is a risk factor. We have antimicrobial resistance, which we know was a big factor explaining the higher mortality, for example, in Italy. So there's factors going in both directions here.
Siddharth, your thoughts on this?
I'll just make two quick points. The first is the speed of transmission of information is enabling societies today to learn almost instantaneously best practices for managing pandemics from across the world, a world of 7 billion people. And I think this has had enormous benefits for how we've been able to respond to the pandemic. And then the second point to add to Sven-Erik, with whom I agree 100%, is our scientific capability, our research capability is far better today than it was in 1918. We were able to sequence the genome of this virus within a few weeks of its emergence. And that's allowed us to speculate about a whole variety of ways to treat or counter the effects of the virus biologically. And I think these two differences between today and 1918 are going to create dramatic differences in outcomes as this pandemic unfolds.
Laura?
I think we're all on the same page. We're basically in better shape. I totally agree. I would just say three things, I think. First of all, zoonoses, these human infections of animal origin, have been emerging with greater frequency over the last few decades. So although we're in better shape, we are still vulnerable to those in a big way. Secondly, one of the lessons to come out of the 1918 pandemic was that you needed a global health agency to coordinate a global response to a pandemic, which is a global health crisis. We have that today, but I think that, you know, we've been moving in a more isolationist direction. Our world is polarized in a geopolitical sense, and you're seeing that in the way that people are not really allowing the WHO, countries not allowing the WHO to coordinate their response. They're acting in a much more nationalistic way than might be ideal. So that, I would argue, is a little unhelpful. And then just to the point of the rapid sharing of information, I think that is a huge boon, but with information comes misinformation, and they both travel at the same speed. And one of the things that young people have been pointing out to me is that news tends to be locked behind paywalls, whereas fake news is free, and that's a problem.
Fantastic thoughts from all three of you. Just a very final question. I'd like to ask you all the same question. What's the fundamental lesson that we can learn from the 1918 epidemic? Siddharth?
The fundamental lesson is, remember your pandemics. You know, the 1918 influenza pandemic is called the mother of all pandemics and the forgotten pandemic. And I think if memory of that pandemic had been preserved and integrated into our health infrastructure today, we perhaps would have been more ready for the COVID-19 pandemic than we were.
Sven-Erik?
Yes. Having a greater or better pandemic preparedness is, of course, important. But maybe even more important is to reduce social inequalities in income and wealth and health and secure most of the population a good healthcare. I think that's the most important lesson that we can give from studying historical pandemics.
Laura.
I think the lesson we should take away is that pandemics happen. We've had 15 flu pandemics in the last 500 years. So they happen. We can't yet prevent them. But humanity essentially decides to a large extent how bad they are.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that's all we've got time for on the forum this week. My thanks to a wonderful panel of experts, Laura Spinney, Siddharth Chandra and Sven Erik Marmeland. This has given me so much food for thought. I'm Bridget Kendall. Thank you for listening.